This video is a tutorial on formatting for Microsoft Excel version 2010. I'm going to be using different examples to illustrate techniques of formatting. This first example on sheet 1 shows 4 columns of data. Unfortunately, none of this data is labeled. Since the data has no labels, it makes it extremely difficult for the user to understand what the data corresponds to. So I'm going to insert labels above these columns of data. To do this, I'm going to insert a single row. By hovering my mouse over the number 1 for row 1 and right-clicking, it gives me the option to insert. This inserts a single row above the selected row. I'm going to insert a second one for additional data in a minute. Now, this first column is a list of lengths corresponding to the side of a cube. So I'm going to type the data label in this cell. As you can see, the label extended beyond the end of the cell into the next one. And to correct this, I'm going to wrap the text within the one cell. The button for this is on the Home tab in the section Alignment. It wrapped the text to 3 lines within one cell. By extending the width of the cell a little bit, I can get it to 2 lines. This makes it easier to read. I'm also going to alter the height of the cell to make the text fit completely within the cell, including no additional space. This next column is the volume of a cube using the length of the side from the previous column. I'm also going to wrap the text in this one. The third column is the surface area of the cube, and I'm also going to widen this cell to make room for the title. And this final column is the volume to area ratio. And since I had wrapped the text in all of the other cells, it automatically wrapped the text in this final one. Generally, you would want to also include the units that correspond with this data. In this case, since the numbers would remain the same no matter the units used, I'm not going to include it, as long as it's consistent through the length, volume, and surface area. Now that my columns are labeled, a user looking at this data can understand what it means. But it's still missing something. One of the most important things about a spreadsheet is to include the name and date at the top of the spreadsheet for the author and when the spreadsheet was created. I'm going to add 2 more rows at the top of the sheet. Now this first row, I'm going to include a name. And now I'm also going to include today's date. There are different ways to enter the date. One of the easiest is typing a formula by entering equal sign, and the word today, followed by an open parenthesis and a closed parenthesis. And by pressing enter, it'll put the date within that cell. You can also go ahead and enter the date manually. If you notice up here, the cell has the format of general. This means it'll automatically select what type of formatting to use. When I enter the date, it changes this to custom to display the date in a different format. There are several different formats to show the date. Since I already have the date entered, I'm going to delete that line. One of the next things to include at the top of the sheet is the class and assignment. If this is not for a class, you don't need to worry about including this. Since this particular example is not for a class, I'm going to type an explanation for what this workbook is for. And finally, I need to title this particular spreadsheet. With all of this information at the top, it doesn't look very nice going from the top to the bottom of the data. So I'm going to insert another row. This separates the information at the top with the data at the bottom. To make the data easier to follow, you can also change the formatting of the labels to make them stand out. For example, if you bold it, it'll darken the text and make it easier to notice and read. And with this example, I'm also going to change the alignment to center to make these labels completely centered within their individual cells. Now, the next example I have is on sheet 2. In this sheet, the data was labeled at the top as temperature versus year. Unfortunately, you can't tell whether this temperature is Fahrenheit or Celsius, or what this data corresponds to. So I'm going to alter this label first by putting its units. Since the cell next to it already has information entered, the rest of this label disappeared. So I'm going to wrap the text, but as you notice, the word Fahrenheit is too long to fit within the cell, so it wraps the word itself. To simplify this, I'm going to shorten Fahrenheit to just an F. Now, the year corresponds to a specific location. Unfortunately, this does not tell you the location, but instead of including it in this label, I'm going to add a title to the spreadsheet for average temperature of Colorado Springs. Now, whenever a user comes to this particular sheet, they can see immediately what this data corresponds to. It is good etiquette to include the name and date at the top of every sheet, but this is not required. As long as you have it at the top of the first sheet, then you don't need to include it on the rest of them. In this case, however, I'm going to go ahead and copy these two rows and insert the copied rows above the title of the spreadsheet. Now, whenever someone looks at any of the sheets, they can automatically see who created the sheet, the date, and what this workbook is for. My final example is on sheet 3. This particular example is from a different video, but we're going to format it to make it easier to follow. Now, the title of the spreadsheet is Metric Conversions, but I'm going to go ahead and insert the name and information from the previous sheet in the top of this one, just to make sure it's consistent through all the sheets. Now, the first conversion example is temperature. To make this stand out from the actual temperature labels, I'm going to bold it, and I'll do the same with length. Now, technically, this is all that you really need to do, because someone looking at the sheet can go and see that the temperature from Fahrenheit to Celsius is this, and that these conversions are through different units of length. But I think I can make this look nicer. First, since this information, distance from Boulder, Colorado to New York, New York, isn't part of the actual data, I'm going to italicize that. So when the user looks at this sheet, they can see that this is additional information about the data. Since this data also is converting to metric units, I'm going to change the formatting of the metric units to demonstrate that this is the answer on the sheet. An easy way to do this is to right-click on the selected cells and go down to Format Cells. Here, you can see several different options on formatting. The Number tab will change the formatting for the different categories. What I want to change in this particular one is to add a border around the cells. I'm just going to include an outline. So when I click on Outline and then OK, there is a black bar surrounding Celsius and the final temperature in Celsius of 18.3. I'm going to do the same for these down here. However, in this case, since there are three different rows, I'm also going to include another horizontal line that separates the rows. If I select OK, you can see that now each of these rows has an individual box around it. If this was for a homework assignment, each of these sheets would be considered a different problem. In that case, you would want to change the name of the sheet to correspond with that. If I go back to sheet 1, and this is problem 1, you double-click on the name sheet 1 and change it to problem 1. And you would do that for each of these. Now let's say that you wanted to put the data from two different problems on the same sheet. Since both of these problems have their data in columns, it would work to put them together. But to do so, you would want to separate your data in a different way. I'm going to add a few more rows here and label my information. So problem 1, which I'm going to bold and underline to make sure it's easily visible. And then here, problem 2, I will do the same kind of formatting. Now when I go to problem 2, I just highlight this information, Control C to copy, go to problem 1, and Control V to paste. And now I have both problem 1 and problem 2 labeled on the same spreadsheet. So since the problem 2 sheet now has information that's already copied someplace else, you can right-click on that sheet and delete it. Problem 3's information is set up in a different way, so it's not in the same kind of columns that problem 1 and 2 are. In this case, it's a good idea to leave it on its own sheet.